is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a great friend of mine, Kim McQueen, hailing from the frozen Arctic, otherwise known as Champaign, Illinois. Hey, Kim, how are you?
Hey, Gary, I'm great. How are you? And thanks for reminding me that I'm in the frozen tundra. I appreciate that.
Well, I flew into Chicago last week, and the ambient air temperature, the actual outside air temperature, was minus 10, and that was before the wind chill. So, Kim, I want to recognize how sturdy you folks are from the Midwest. You know, I made a comment as I was looking outside at a change plane. You know, the airport was 70 degrees, so I was perfectly fine.
Yes, it was. And it's, I tell you, it never ceases to amaze me how we just keep trudging through it. And this morning I was actually up shoveling the new snow off the driveway and at about, I think, 10 degrees. And I asked myself then, you do this, why? But, you know, we do what we do, I guess. It builds character, right?
That's right. I made a comment that as it was minus 10 and I was looking out the window of the plane I had, it was changing planes to, and I saw the baggage handlers and the ramp agents, and, you know, I just made a comment that, man, those folks are sturdy, and let's take a minute and appreciate them because, man, they're outside working in minus 10 degree weather and with a smile on their face and working their tails off. So, hey, for all those hardworking, you know, folks out there that have to endure the elements, let's remember to say thanks to them because, you know, they made it possible for me to make my flight to my speaking engagement. So thanks for all those hardworking folks, huh?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, hey, I'm really excited to have Kim on our show today because we're going to talk about a topic that is near and dear to my heart and also to hers, and that is the role of the office manager today in a successful practice. So, hey, Kim, what a cool topic, huh?
Yeah, it is, and you're right. It's one that's near and dear to my heart. I've got experience with that role, and it's so amazing to me to see how it's evolved over, you know, the past years and you know, evolved in a very positive way in my opinion.
You and I are cohorts on that message. That's for sure. Hey, let's give some background. Many of our listeners will know you, Kim. You're very active on social media. You're very active professionally, and many of our listeners will know you. But for those of you that don't know Kim, let me take a minute and give a little bit of Kim's background. Kim has a fantastic dental background. Almost 30 years in dentistry. Almost 30 years. Now, I will emphasize that Kim started in dentistry before there were child labor laws. And she started as a very young girl, but she has almost 30 years of experience in dentistry. She spent many years with a company that I think a great deal of, Patterson Dental. Kim has a deep background in many of the business and administrative sides of dentistry, marketing, team building, systems. And today she spends her time doing a number of things, one of which is Kim is the executive director of the American Association of Dental Office Managers, otherwise known by the acronym ADOM. Kim also started her own consulting firm, which I absolutely love the name. You've got the most fantastic name of a dental business. That name is Common Sense Dental Advisors. Common Sense Dental Advisors. What a great name.
Yes, it's just not rocket science. That's what drove me to that name. I think sometimes people do think it is, and it really isn't. It's just common sense.
Yeah, but you know what? The rather famous radio show host and financial expert Dave Ramsey has a saying. You're familiar with that saying, Kim, but in case our listeners are not, his saying is, the one thing about common sense is it's not so common.
True. Very true.
And in the same way with Common Sense Dental Advisors, while it's not necessarily rocket science, there sometimes there's a lack of common sense. But we're going to talk about a lot of things today, including some of the cool things that ADOM, the American Association of Dental Office Managers, is doing. Kim's the executive director there. It's a fantastic organization. As a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, if you're not familiar with ADOM, I want you to become familiar with it. Furthermore, we're going to encourage you, I'm going to encourage you to take a step and become a member. One of the greatest organizations to give your team members support and education and networking that just doesn't exist anywhere else. In fact, you know, Kim, before ADOM, you know, most subgroups in dentistry have their own associations. You know, of course, dentists have their associations. They're often aligned clinically. You know, we have associations like AACD, the American Academy of Cosmetic Dentists. Of course, we have the American Dental Association. We have AOSH, the American Association of Oral Systemic Health. You know, hygienists have their associations. Dental assistants have their associations. And for a long time, there was one group in dentistry that really didn't have a club. You know, this is my view. Correct me if I'm wrong on this, Kim, but for a long time, there was one group that really didn't have a club, and it was our office managers and our administrative team members. And anyway, I believe it was about 11 years ago. I could have the date wrong, but correct me if I'm wrong on that, but I believe it was about 11 years ago. Heather Colicchio and a number of others formed American Association of Dental Office Managers to create a forum and a voice for office managers and administrative team members. And I try to direct my clients. We're members. We love it, and we love the education that's provided for our team members. And it is a resource that I would not want to practice without.
Well, we certainly appreciate that. And you know, it's you're right. Heather formed this association. It will be 11 years this year. We celebrated our 10th anniversary last year. And, you know, she started it from nothing, actually. And I know you'll get more information about this if you get an opportunity to talk to her in detail. But she was in the coffee business. And she actually started in dental by a very interesting story. And I would encourage anybody who has the opportunity definitely to check out the association, look at the history of it, how it started. Just this, the way it started itself will show you that it was a woman with incredible determination, and she has become really an icon in my mind in dental. And she did. She created a resource that now is growing and is bigger than ever and provides more resources than ever for this very unique group of individuals that, you know, it's an overlooked, sometimes overlooked position in the office, I think. And by my standards, should be the one that is got the spotlight on it. And I think Heather helps to bring that education and that, you know, that opportunity to shine that light on that position. She's done an excellent job, and we're growing, and we have more members than ever, and it's just been a great opportunity to work with her and with this whole association and the team that makes up ADOM.
Wonderful. Kim, perhaps you could, you know, just as a, we'll give our listeners a little bit of a tease, perhaps you could help us get Heather on the show as a guest, and she and I can explore a little bit more about ADOM and what benefits they provide, and we'll even talk more about the office manager position and how they support it. Let's work on getting that done, huh?
I love that idea, and I will. I'll be speaking to her this week, and I will definitely put that bug out there. And Gary, I know she has great respect for you and for all you do. So I have a feeling that won't be in the
show. Well, we know people in high places, right, Kim?
You betcha.
Well, hey, that's a perfect bridge into our topic today. And let's dive right in. Hey, Kim, to start with, you know, you've been in dentistry almost 30 years. It's 35 for me this year. Can you imagine that? And we've seen changes, you know, over time. How do you think, and they've been accelerating in the last little while. How do you think the role of the office manager has changed, say, in the last 5 years or so?
Well, it's the last 5 years, you're right, it's accelerated. And you know, when I started in this business, the office manager was, and unfortunately in some practices still is, you know, they referred to that person as the front desk person, or if you go back even further than 5 years, the front desk girl, or the receptionist, or, you know, the gatekeeper, that, you know, their role was just simply to keep everybody out of the practice that the doctor didn't want to see.
In fact, Kim, we even have a friend, a mutual friend of ours, Lisa Spradley, who has playfully, she was called so many times the front desk lady. Yep. That she has playfully accepted that title in a playful way, and playfully she refers to herself as the front desk lady.
Yes, she does, and you know, it just is amazing to me that you know, that's what that role was. That's what they were there to do. They were there to, you know, put up the wall between the dentist and anybody that the dentist didn't want to see, and you know, they were bulldog, you know. They answered the phone, they made the appointments, they sent out the reminder postcard, and it's interesting to me that over the last especially 5 years, that role is so changing. What I see now are business managers. You know, they handle, they manage the staff, they handle the payroll, they you know, all of the compliance issues, which we all know in this day and age, the dreaded compliance issues that they have to adhere to, they educate themselves on that. They oversee the marketing. And, you know, I have office managers that I've worked with that, you know, in this day and age, they actually oversee the process for the building of a new practice. If a dentist is adding on, or the remodel, you know, they handle all of that. They work with contractors. They work with, you know, again, compliance-related issues. They understand everything from new patient care to how to build a building and a foundation. And yeah, it just amazes me that role has evolved to that. And it is, it's exciting. It's impressive. And I'm glad to see that role making those types of changes. And I'm sure you would agree. You've seen it as much as I have.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you, Kim. In fact, to amplify some of those different roles, you're absolutely right. When we, when Paul and I built our new office building in April of 2011, we purchased a shell space. It was a space within a two-story professional building, and it was just shell, four walls and a concrete floor. And when we built that office in late 2010 and early 2011, our front desk team members were very much a role of coordinators, project coordinators for us. And while there were many things that Paul and I had to do, they really helped us with that process, and we could have never done it without it. You know, to emphasize another point, Kim, you know, I've myself have been in over 2,100 practices as a coach and as a consultant, and I love being, and I still today, I'm on a typical day, I'm in an office somewhere around the country coaching, consulting, and recently I went into an office, and I love doing this because it gives me, I learn things every day, and I saw a wonderful business card for a front desk team member. And I'll share it with you, Kim, and I'll share it with our listeners. It was very creative. This was a fun office, very successful office. They brought me in because they wanted to take a successful practice and make it even better. The business card for it was a two-person front office. One of the business cards read, Director of First Impressions. Isn't that a cool title? You know, and of course she does many, many things, but she likes to think of herself as, you know, really the face and, you know, the presentation of the office. It's the first person people see when they come in. And, you know, very, very talented person. She's actually the office manager, but the title that she put on her card was the director of first impressions, and it was meant to be kind of an icebreaker conversation starter for patients. And she's actually the office manager and does a fabulous job of it.
And it's interesting to me, Gary, too, because I tell people frequently now, as you know, when I make phone calls to speak to the office manager in some of the practices that we work with, I jokingly say now, you know, that back in the day, the office manager or the front desk person was the gatekeeper for the doctor. And now, in the larger practices where they have, you know, multiple team members, I find that the gatekeeper has a gatekeeper. So now the office manager has, you know, somebody who might actually be the receptionist or the person who's hired to really make that first contact. They're trying to keep people away from the office manager because the role has changed in such a way that, you know, they're busy and they want to make sure that, you know, their time is spent wisely. So it's interesting to watch how a gatekeeper now has a gatekeeper.
Yeah. One of the cool things that I've seen evolve, you know, over time has been the doctor's perception of the office manager. And, you know, I've seen that evolve. I remember a time, you know, having started in this wonderful profession 35 years ago. I remember that time, you know, when our business or administrative team members were referred to as front desk girls. I remember that time. I'm very happy that that's generally in the rearview mirror, you know, these days. But occasionally I bump into that and I try to gently correct and gently nudge. Kim, how have you seen the doctor's perception of the office manager change? Again, it's changed over time, but it's really been kind of accelerated in the last few years. How have you seen that really change over the last few years?
Well, I think in the successful practices, you know, the busy ones, let's put it that way, I think the doctor who recognizes that this is a business manager, that it's not just a person who answers their phones, I think they recognize, when they recognize that, they're successful. And I do see it more and more. And I have a couple of doctors, even here in the state of Illinois, several in Chicago that, you know, that do recognize that. And they say, I wouldn't be able to do what I do without the individual who manages my business. And that's different than manages my dental office or manages, you know, my practice. It's manages my business, because that to me means more than just the operations part. They actually manage the, you know, all of the ancillary things, the build outs, the what software should we be looking at? Should I purchase this new piece of equipment? The dentists that really understand that this person manages the business, they're successful. But the other thing they start to recognize is, you know, I get to do what I want to do, which is the dentistry, the clinical. I went to school because I love dentistry. I didn't go to school because I want to be a business manager. And frequently doctors will tell me, they didn't teach me this in school. I have no idea what I'm doing here. And in many cases, they don't want to deal with it. They would love to have a business manager that can take that burden off so that they can do what they consider the fun stuff, which they should do because that's where they're trained.
Well, and let's talk about this a little bit, Kim, because you know, I've made it my life's work to study successful dentists and successful practices. And one of the common denominators among any successful practice is that the dentist or dentists understand the importance of leverage, of leveraging their time and how they choose to spend their time. And the reality is if we can delegate to competent team members, provide the training, provide the resources, and we can delegate to competent team members, then it allows the dentist to do what he or she not only does best, but truly loves to do, you know, which is to be in the mouth providing dental care. You know, so an example of that, for example, on the clinical side, Kim, just to branch off on clinical for just a minute, I love incorporating photography for patient education. You know, we take digital photos of patients and then we load them onto an iPod, iPad, and show the patients their photos. And, you know, when I'm visiting offices and teaching offices, very often the dentist is the one taking the photos.
Sure.
And I quickly tell them that, hey, over time, let's have your assistant take those photos. And sometimes they look at me like, well, I think I'm the only one that can do it. I said, well, let me be open-minded to this, because in our office, our assistants take those photos, and they take them brilliantly, because then you can be in the next room doing something else. And quickly they embrace that concept. And the same thing can happen administratively. So if the dentist can have, you know, competent, well-trained, well-supported team members that can support the business side of the practice, they can spend their time and energy in the mouth with patients providing clinical care. And I just can't emphasize how important that role of leveraging is, and what a great lesson there is. If you want to grow your practice, grow your team members. And
absolutely.
So if you're listening to this and you have a front desk team member that you tend to think of as a receptionist, let's look at developing that person into the role of the office manager. It may not happen overnight. They may need some resources, and they may need some support. They may need some training, but you might be surprised how much they can do when you simply provide direction, you provide expectations, and you provide the training. You might be surprised how much they could do. Kim, would you agree with that?
Absolutely. And in many cases, what the dentist may not realize is that that individual is looking for that opportunity. You know, they're chomping at the bit to take on more responsibility and to help the practice grow. And I mean, ultimately, of course, we all know at the end of the day, as the practice grows, the team grows and the individuals grow. And you may be surprised that, wow, I had no idea that, you know, this individual even wanted this responsibility. So, and, you know, one other note to that, when we were talking earlier about the changing role of the office manager, and we've kind of jokingly been saying the front desk lady or the girl who answers the phone. One of the things that I'm seeing, Gary, and I don't know if you are as well, but we are definitely seeing more males in the role of office manager, practice administrator, practice manager. And so that brings a whole new perspective to things as well.
You know, you're so, right. I am noticing that it's still a trend that is developing, but I am certainly seeing that. And Kim, with you and I having, you know, 30 plus year perspective, we've certainly seen that change radically, you know, in our tenure in dentistry. We've certainly seen that change, haven't we?
Right. Absolutely. And it's a change for the better. You know, I don't think it's a bad change, obviously. But it does bring an interesting perspective to the position. You know, and I'm learning quite a bit from some of these male office managers. You know, there's one in Las Vegas that is a very active ADOM member, and he just brings a different perspective to it. He's a younger dental office manager, and he looks at things very differently than, you know, I'm a woman, so I can say this, than maybe somebody like me who's been in dental for a very long time and coming at it from a female perspective. And I think that we can learn from that, and we should welcome that different perspective.
Great point. Hey, Kim, I want to branch into a side discussion. You and I didn't talk about this ahead of time, so I'm going to branch off into some dangerous territory. But somehow, I think you and I are simply siblings from a different mother. And and I suspect this will be a fun conversation. So while I might have you a little bit nervous right now, Kim, let's dive into this. I happen to believe, and I teach my clients, that sharing financial information with our team members is very important. Our practice among team members and among doctors and myself, you know, we have two doctors, myself, Paul and I co-own the practice together, and then we have 8 team members. We share financial information with our team, with one exception, Kim. And the one exception is, I believe individual compensation should be between the owners of the practice and that team member. Otherwise, we share information. They know what we produce. They know what we collect. They have budgets in terms of expensing. How do you feel about sharing financial information among our team members?
I absolutely agree with that. I support it. And to your point, I mean, with the exception, of course, of personal, wages and such.
Personal, individual, their compensation package, which might be wages, it might be benefits, it might be different perks associated with that. I believe that should be private, because that's the agreement between the team member and the owners of the practice. Otherwise, I believe in sharing information.
Absolutely. And I totally agree with that. And the more that your team knows about the inner workings of the practice, the more that your team is aware of the goals of the practice, is aware of where are they falling within those goals. The more open door that you can make things, the better. And because it provides that opportunity for the team members to feel like, you know what, I am vested in this and I do see the growth, we didn't hit that goal. What can we do to change that? And it becomes more of a, it's a goal for them then to help the practice grow. They don't feel like it's, well, I come in, I put in my 8 hours or my 7 hours or my 6 hours or whatever, and I go home and I don't even think about this place. You know, I'm not encouraging people to get to the level of they're constantly thinking about the practice, obviously. But I think if you can create an environment where it's open, where information is shared, with the exception of that personal information, it just creates an environment where people are willing to do more, and because they feel that they're vested in it. And so I'm a big proponent of sharing those financials. And I think that also puts the doctor or the owners in a different light. It doesn't put them in a light of, well, you know, he's the doctor and he's the owner, and you know, we can't ask those types of questions, or we're not privy to that information. I sometimes hear that from office managers. Well, we're not privy to that information.
Right.
And you know, the more information you're privy to, so to speak, I think the more healthy the practice will be.
Well, knock the top off this one, Kim, because occasionally it doesn't happen every day, but occasionally, I'll bump into a doctor either at a course that I'm giving, and will talk to me privately at a break, and he or she will say something like, "Well, I just don't. I think some of that information is sensitive." So Kim, I think I'll role play with you for a minute. Let me be a protagonist on this. Kim, I think some of that information is sensitive, and I just, I don't believe in sharing, for example, our production and collection numbers with our team. How would you address that from your perspective? And then I'll take a shot at it as well.
Sure. I mean, and from my perspective, I think I would share that, well, you know, doctor, that the more information you can share, the more effective your goal setting will be and the outcome of achieving those goals. I certainly agree that there are pieces of information within your practice that shouldn't be shared, and you know, wages and benefits and team, you know, individual employee compensation is definitely one of those. But the more information you share with your practice, your team, including the production information, how can you expect your team members to effectively meet production goals or even set production goals and grow your practice if you're not willing to share the outcome of those numbers and what you're doing? It's kind of like asking somebody like myself to go build the Empire State Building when I don't even know where to begin. So give them a foundation of where to start, and then show them regularly, here's where we are, and here's where we are on that line of the goal and how to improve.
I knew that we were soulmates, Kim. Because I feel the same way. In fact, I'll simply echo what you said, and I'll simply say that, doctor, team members can't help you get there if they don't know where there is. They can't help you unless they have that information. And I'll tell you, it's been a fabulous experience. And I think it's an important part of our culture in our practice to share that information. Of course, it's confidential. We ask our team members not to share that, you know, beyond our circle of team. And I have trust in them. Kim, may I share an amusing story with you related to this? This is many years ago, and the numbers will reflect that it was many years ago, but the story is relevant today. I went into a practice many years ago, and there was so much tension that you could literally feel the tension, and it was as if you could cut it in the air. There was so much tension in this practice. And so during our team meeting, we weren't getting anywhere because there was so much tension. So I politely uninvited the doctor to our team meeting. And I,
oh, I can only guess what happened.
Yeah. I literally said, doctor, you know, male dentist. And I said, doctor, would it be all right if I uninvited you to this meeting and you went, down to Starbucks and gave us a little bit of time. And he said, okay. And he left. And I then had the team. And I simply just in a very candid, very transparent way, just said, obviously there's some tension here. And I could tell very quickly that it was mainly around money. The tension was around money. And it was, you know, you didn't have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. And I had some 3x5 index cards in my briefcase, and I pulled those out and passed one around to each team member. And I said, I want you to write down how much money you think the doctor makes. Just want you to write that down, whatever you think it is. Anonymous, you don't have to tell me who it is. Write it down on a piece of paper. Now, Kim and our listeners, this was a practice that at that time was producing and collecting $500,000 a year. Okay? Got it, Kim? Producing and collecting $500,000 a year. By the way, the office had rather high overhead at that time. We were able to correct it later, but that office had almost 80% overhead. The doctor was making about $110,000 a year in pre-tax income, which was not enough, by the way. But the doctor was making about $110,000. Okay, so when I collected those cards, the highest number that anyone wrote down was 750. Now, this is how much the doctor made. The highest number was $750,000, and the lowest number was $400,000.
Wow.
So one team member, and I love this, I'm reading the cards, and I actually started laughing, you know, and the team, and I said, please, no, I'm not making fun of anyone. I'm just laughing because I later asked the doctor if I had permission to share the information with the team. He said, absolutely, because whatever we're doing now isn't working. You have my permission to do something different, Gary. And so once I had his permission, I shared it. And I said, and they had no knowledge of production and collection in the practice. And I said, the office produces and collects about $500,000 a year. And their eyes got really big. And I said, and one of you thought he makes $750. I would love to know that magic trick that you could actually make more money than the practice produced.
Absolutely.
Furthermore, I would love to know how to net 400 out of 500. Wouldn't you, Kim?
Absolutely.
And when I told them,
that goes for wherever you are, you know, wherever you are on the globe, if your production isn't coming in, you can't pay more than you bring in. You just simply can't do it.
By the way, if anybody knows how to do that, please email me and I'll have you on the show.
Absolutely. And make sure that I know when that is.
Absolutely. I'll make sure you listen to that one as well. But anyway, I have to continue the story though, Kim, because as I shared with the team, the tension started to relieve. And one of the team members said, when I said, I have doctor's permission to share this with you, doctor last year made about $110,000. And one of the team members said, wow, he deserves more than that. And then the whole tone started to change. And it was interesting. Then I said, just for my own benefit, why did you think he made that much? And the comments, and again, this was we now had a very comfortable environment. People were talking. One of the team members said, well, you know, he drives a nice car. He lives in a nice house. They take nice vacations. And of course, most of that, sadly, you know, was on credit cards and extended. Fortunately, all that's changed for this doctor over time. But, you know, at the time, you know, he was extended and that he had the trappings of success. But in fact, when they learned he made only 110, collectively as a team, they rallied and said, hey, let's figure out how we can help doctor make more money. And I love telling that story because I believe that that story exists in some way or form in many practices.
Absolutely. Yeah. I agree with that.
But Kim, if you ever learn, please just file this way in the back of your mind. If you ever learn how to net more than the practice actually produces, would you please share that tip with me?
Absolutely, I will. And you do the same because, yes, that's a very intriguing concept. That is
that's right.
One that would be very successful for anybody who could actually pull it off.
Right. Well, hey, I want to talk about something really fun that I know our listeners will love. And you're a master of many skills. Kim, I have great admiration for your skills. And I can imagine as the executive director of ADOM, one of the things you need to do is prioritize, because if you don't prioritize your time and effort, you could spin off in many different directions. I can imagine there's a workload on your desk, you know, as when you put on your hat as the executive director of ADOM. If you don't prioritize your effort, you're not going to achieve the goals of the organization. Can you help our listeners understand more about prioritizing and perhaps how they can guide their office managers and teach them about the role of prioritizing?
Well, I think there are days, and I know you would probably agree with this, and I'm sure everybody would agree with this, that, you know, there are days when you feel like, whoa, I didn't prioritize as well as I probably should have. So, and I think what's important, especially from a dental practice perspective, I think one of the most important things is that, at least from my perspective, and I know from many and yours, I'm assuming, the patient has to be first. And thank you.
Thank you, Kim. Yes.
I know that, again, that's not rocket science, I know. But
Wait a minute. What's the name of your consulting firm again?
That's right. Common Sense Dental Advisor.
Okay. I'm starting to get this. Okay. I'm kidding, Kim, but thank you for pointing that out, because, for example, we've talked about numbers here, and I'll share something. Kim, again, we didn't talk about this, so if you feel differently, please chime in, because there's differences of opinions. But I believe that if the doctor or the office manager looks at that patient walking through the door as a dollar sign, I believe we've got some misguided priorities. Would you agree with me on that?
Absolutely. And it's unfortunate, because there are some practices that do feel that way. Again, in my opinion, the successful ones don't. They recognize that the patient is the patient, for starters, but the patient is a human being. The patient is somebody who, a mutual friend of ours that is a mutual friend of most of the dental industry, Fred Joyle told me one time, you know, that you have the ability to change people's lives. You really, really do. And when the team recognizes that, and when the team believes that, then it just takes the practice to a whole different level and brings it about a whole different perspective. I have so many office managers and that share stories with me. One of the great things about being the executive director of ADOM is I get to meet so many people from around the world, and it's awesome. Because they share stories with me about how they will get a card in the mail, a thank you card in the mail from a patient who says, thank you so much for taking care of me the way you did. I don't know what I would have done without the treatment you provided. You know, dental practices can change lives. And I think when people recognize that, when they treat those patients as human beings, as part of their family, so to speak, then things, the environment changes, the patient base grows. And so from my perspective, number one priority in the dental practice is the patient, and how do we make that patient experience the best that it can be?
I love the word that you use there, experience, because you didn't say appointment. You didn't say visit. It is both of those. It's an appointment. It's a visit. But you use the word experience, which has connotation. It implies that the time we spend with them is more than an appointment. And I love that, because just that perspective alone can start to change how we interact with our patients. You know, Kim, I give a course these days that, in fact, I'll be speaking tomorrow in Arkansas, giving a course called Dentistry Rocks. And I chose that title for a number of reasons, but one of the reasons why I chose that title is that I truly believe that the dental profession rocks. And the reason I do is exactly what you said, and that is that every day we have the opportunity to change people's lives. And if we can create a culture in your practice around that concept, so many good things follow. And I'm so glad. It's so great to hear that from another voice. I just love that. I love our collective voice on this.
Yeah, and I would go so far as to say, again, I'm going to steal a quote from my friend Fred. You know, the the experience in your practice with your patients, the experience in my mind matters more than your expertise. And for some doctors, that's very hard to accept or comprehend. But at the end of the day, if you performed the best root canal in the world, it doesn't matter if on the way out the door, the patient had a horrible checkout experience. It doesn't matter. They will forget everything you did. And the last thing they're going to remember is how they were treated when they walked out the door.
Sadly.
So, yeah, the experience is so crucial in today's day.
Let me punctuate that, Kim. Can you imagine in your reality, Kim, can you imagine two people, lay people, not dental people, can you imagine two lay people ever having a conversation about canine guidance between each other?
No.
But could you imagine two people, you're in Champaign, Illinois, it's a wonderful wonderful town. Can you imagine two people in Champaign having a conversation about how much they love Kelly, their hygienist, because every time they come in, Kelly remembers their name. And not only that, but Kelly remembers the important things in their life. Can you imagine that conversation ever happening?
Absolutely.
Every day. Hey, let's give some, hopefully we've inspired our listeners to perhaps develop their team members into the role of office manager, or in some cases, they may be thinking of hiring one. Kim, can you give our listeners some tips to look for in hiring an office manager?
Absolutely. And it's interesting. I do get this question when I speak around the country. I get this question frequently from doctors. And I was in Indianapolis late last year and spoke to a study club there. And that was one of the things, one of the doctors approached me during a break and said, you know, you talk about this role and how important it is. And you've sold me. I'm living the example that you said about how I'm trying to manage everything and I don't have time to do what's fun, which is for me, the clinical dentistry. So where do I hire an office manager?
So you had him at hello.
I had him at hello for sure. And, you know, I felt so sorry for him because you could just see he was just at his wit's end. He was frazzled. He had a team that, you know, he didn't want to be managing because he admittedly said, this isn't my skill set. My skill set is working with patients and helping to improve their dental care. And I said, okay, well, I said, my first recommendation to you is to strongly consider looking outside of dentistry to hire your practice manager. Mm. And I tell people that because if you have a business manager who is skilled in managing a business, then you know, so you've got a savvy business manager, you've got somebody who has experience managing people effectively, you know what? You can teach dentistry. You can't teach managing a team. You can't teach motivating a team. You can't teach managing the dollars and cents on the backside. At least you can't teach those things quickly. Let's put it that way. Those skill sets are learned over time. And depending on where you're at in your practice, you know, it may be okay to hire somebody that's coming right out of dental. But many times I suggest looking outside of dental. And the other reason for that is it brings a whole different perspective into your practice. You know, you've got somebody who's coming in that doesn't know the dental industry. They know the business side and they know how to manage people. And those are important. And if they can manage the team in an effective way, in a motivational way, trust me, like you were speaking earlier about the team wanting to do better to reward the doctor more, they'll do that as well for the office manager. They'll help train the dental side, and they'll help educate, and they'll help guide that office manager from a procedural coding, et cetera, experience. If they're treated well and they see a business manager that is working with them, is helping to promote them and helping to grow the team, they will very easily come along and support that office manager. So I tell people, you know, first and foremost, consider looking outside of dentistry. There are times when that won't work, depending on what you're doing, but I would strongly suggest looking outside of dentistry. I don't know what your thoughts are.
Well, that's an excellent point. And I've had great success stories that I could tell you, Kim, about bringing team members from outside of dentistry, in particular office managers from outside of dentistry. And for example, I'll just throw out some numbers here just for the sake of conversation. They're not meant to be cryptic, but you know, if you had $1 million practice, a practice that produced and collected $1 million, and we had a candidate who came from outside of dentistry that was a manager of a restaurant that had $1.2-1.3 million in sales, that might be a very good fit. If that person came from a print shop, a printing operation that had $1 million in revenue, that might be a good experience base to match up with your needs as a dental business. So I agree, and I agree that our listeners should be open to hiring someone from outside of dentistry, especially if we can provide them the resources, which really provides me a nice bridge to talk about the last thing that I want to talk about today, which is ADOM. The American Association of Dental Office Managers. Listeners, if you've never heard of ADOM, I'm going to put their website on the show notes, in the show notes, and I want to encourage you to visit the website. It's fantastic. I look at ADOM as a critical resource in my practice. I wouldn't want to practice without my ADOM membership. Kim, can you tell our listeners a little bit about ADOM? I know you do an annual meeting every year. You've got one coming up in August of 2015. Would you tell our listeners a little bit about ADOM and about that annual meeting?
Sure. So ADOM, which again, as you said in the beginning, is the American Association of Dental Office Managers. And it's interesting because we are really starting to migrate to more of the American Association of Dental Office Management, because we do find many times within the practice that the office manager doesn't have that title. You know, they may be practice administrator, they may be, chief of operations or operations director, et cetera. So we're finding that title isn't always the title that's given, front desk person, for instance. But we are the only association that is dedicated to that role. And we are, you know, of course, we're based in North America, but we have members all over the globe. One of our fun stories is we have a group of practice managers that come all the way from Romania to our conference every year.
Yes.
And I will say they've been there for probably the last 5 years that I know of. But they're just a wonderful group of people. You know, we have people in Canada, et cetera.
I remember meeting that group when I was at your meeting in 2012 in Scottsdale.
Yeah. And they're just a fabulous group. And you know, we are a virtual association, of course, but we do have an annual meeting every year. And you're correct. This year it is August 28th through the 30th in Nashville, Tennessee. It will be held at the beautiful Gaylord Opryland Resort. So the meeting, we tend to hold our meetings within the hotel where everyone's staying, so that they don't have to get out and about, but yet have opportunities to do that, you know, on the downtime. So that's where we'll be. But we have a variety of resources that are available to our members, and our primary goal is to provide networking and educational opportunities for our members. And we have everything from a members-only private forum where they exchange ideas, they ask questions, they look for resources amongst each other. Again, it's private to them, and they camaraderie within the forum is amazing. You know, you've got over 3,000 peers across the globe who are standing at the ready to support you. You know, many times I think the role of the practice manager, the office manager, they feel like they're on an island. You know, to your point earlier, my hygienist has an association, the dentist has an association, the assistants have an association. I'm out here by myself, and this provides them with an opportunity that, you know what, you're not alone, and there are resources here for you. So for everything from our members forum to our article library, our weekly e-newsletters filled with dental articles about practice management, we have an educational program, designation program, a professional designation program, that is the fellow of the American Association of Dental Office Managers. And it's a pretty extensive process, but I can tell you, with just shy of 200 FADOMs across the globe, All of them would be impressed. They are the cream of the crop. And now they have a designation to put on their business card, just like the dentist has DDS or DMD and the hygienist has, you know, RDH. So we have online courses and educational opportunities that range from just the initial training of someone who's never been in dental with the foundations of dental practice management to our online virtual study club, which is an annual session that features some of the best speakers in the world. So, you know, the resources abound. We are constantly adding new resources. And, you know, 2015 is going to be an exciting year for us. We're focusing on ADOM local chapters, which are extensions of the National Association to help with, you know, regional meetings, study club type setup, regional meetings that help fill the void in between those conferences. We frequently hear from our members that, man, I wish I could attend this conference every year. I'm so invigorated and so excited to go back and implement everything that I've learned. And so we're starting ADOM chapters this year. So that is exciting.
Very cool.
Yeah. So there's a lot of opportunity. The conference itself is just jam-packed, 3 days full of again, some of the best speakers in the world. Gary, you've spoken for us yourself, and we certainly appreciate that. Look forward to the opportunity to have you back again. And you know, it's just jam-packed, and it's filled with pertinent things for dental practice management. And it's not clinical, and the networking is incredible. And our members frequently build long-lasting lifetime relationships with the peers that they interact with, and many of them become best friends. And you know, it's interesting to watch them over Facebook and Google Plus and all of the social media how they connect.
So, you know, and while the meeting is packed with content, I have to tell you, it's one of the most fun dental meetings I ever go to. It's just a blast. And I have to tell you, Kim, you know, the part that I love most about your meeting is the FAA DOM award ceremony. When you award the fellowship to the candidates that have passed the process in the last year, and just to see the pride and to see their faces and just how they're glowing and beaming, you know, about being recognized for their hard work and their accomplishment. It's just one of the coolest things, absolutely. And I'll just be very blunt with our listeners. As a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you are a perfect match. You're interested in business. You're interested in taking care of your patients. You're interested in improvement. You all need to be members of AADOM. So I'm going to put that website, ADOM's website, on the show notes. And Kim, I know that a lot of our listeners would like to reach out to you. Would you mind providing your website address? And again, if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. I'm going to put this in a link on the show notes. But Kim, would you provide our listeners with your website address and also your email address, if you would?
Sure, absolutely, and I would be happy to do that in just a moment. But I'm gonna throw a curve at you, Gary, because we didn't talk about this. But I've been sitting here, and one of the things I would like to do for you from an ADOM perspective, for your listeners, actually, I want to extend a code that, if you will include in the notes, to your listeners, that if they use this code, they go to our website and they're not members and they join. I'm going to give them a code that allows them to get their first year membership for $99.
So, wow.
Yeah, the annual membership is normally $164. So we'll put this out here for, you know, we'll put it out there for a couple of months just so all of your listeners have a chance to use it. But when they go to the Join Now page, there is a promotional code box, and have them just simply enter AADOM 2015. And that's all capital letters, all run together. And that will reduce the rate down to $99. And all I ask is that where they have the "how are you referred to us," just put in Thriving Dentist, and that will tell us that they came from you. And
perfect.
And they will get a great welcome. So,
Kim, thank you. We didn't talk about that. Thank you for doing that. Well, what a great benefit to our listeners. So again, that code, the promotional code, AADOM 2015. You'll get your first year's annual membership at $99. That has got to be the best investment in dentistry. Way to go. Thank you, Kim.
Absolutely. That's less than, you know, the regular membership, $164, only $14 a month. So I can't quickly do the math there, but you can do the math and figure, you know,
$8.33. I'm I'm a nerd when it comes to math, Kim. Sorry. $8.33.
Sure.
What's that? That's two Starbucks?
No, well, not even that.
A Starbucks and a half?
There you go.
Thank you, Kim. How can our listeners reach you?
Absolutely. They can reach me. My email address is kim@commonsensedentaladvisors.com. And of course, my website is just commonsensedentaladvisors.com. And there's a contact information on there, all of my information about how I work with dental practices and even dental associations across the globe. So I would be interested in any feedback that people have, or if they have questions or whatever they need, just have them contact me through those two mediums.
Well, let me invite our listeners to reach out to Kim, and even if it's just a quick email that says thanks for being on the show, please reach out to her and connect with her if you would. And Kim, I want to take a minute and say thank you. You know, you and I get to bump into each other 4 or 5 times a year at meetings. In fact, every year, one of my highlights is seeing you at the dental prom every year in Chicago. You know what I'm referring to, right?
Absolutely.
Health America Gala. Oral Health America Gala, better known colloquially as the Dental Prom. It's a black tie optional affair, wonderful charity fundraiser. And Kim, I get to see you every year there. And you look stunning every year dressed up. And anyway, it's so fun to get to see you around dental meetings every year and connect our friendship face-to-face when we're not connected via social media or common friends. But I want to thank you for all that you do. It's a 30-year-plus career of commitment to our profession, and I want to thank you for all you do.
Absolutely, and thank you so much for having me. This has really been a blast, and I do look forward to seeing you next month back in the frozen tundra of Chicagoland.
I'll be at the dental prom.
To all of your listeners who are listening to this, I wish you a great day, and hopefully this has been beneficial, and you can walk away with some tidbits that are going to help grow that practice.
I sure hope so. And Kim, you provide lots of great takeaways for our listeners. And as a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, I want to take a minute and say thanks to you. We love what we do here, but we couldn't do it if it wasn't for you. So let me take a minute and reach out and say thank you. And thank you. And I have a request. If you're a regular listener and you like what you hear, if you wouldn't mind going to iTunes and just write us a review on iTunes. We have many, many reviews, but we're always interested in more. And the reviews will help more dentists find the show. It'll allow us to be ranked higher in the iTunes directory and will help more dentists and dental professionals find us. So if you wouldn't mind, when you get back to your desk, go to iTunes, search for the Thriving Dentist Show. By the way, you can subscribe to it on iTunes as well. If you subscribe to it, it's free. That means that every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be uploaded directly to your listening device. You don't have to do anything at all. So if you're interested in subscribing to it, I'd invite you to do that. But while you're there, take a minute and write us a review if you would. On that basis, let me simply say thank you and let you know I'll look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.